Now let's look at the electrical view of the MOSFET. Its operation is determined by the voltages of its four terminals. First, we'll label the two diffusion terminals on either side of the gate terminal. Our convention is to call the diffusion terminal with the highest voltage potential the drain, and the other lower potential terminal as source. With this labeling, if any current is flowing through the MOSFET switch, it will flow from drain to source. When the MOSFET is manufactured, it's designed to have a particular threshold voltage, VTH, which tells us when the switch goes from non-conducting or open to conducting or closed. For the n-channel MOSFET shown here, we'd expect VTH to be around half a volt in a modern process. The P-plus terminal on the left of the diagram is the connection to the P-type substrate. For the MOSFET to operate correctly, the substrate must always have a voltage less than or equal to the voltage of the source and drain. We'll have specific rules about how to connect up this terminal. The MOSFET is controlled by the difference between the voltage of the gate, VG, and the voltage of the source, VS, which, following the usual terminology for voltages, we'll call VGS, a shortcut for saying VG minus VS. The first picture shows the configuration of the MOSFET when VGS is less than the MOSFET's threshold voltage. In this configuration, the switch is open or non-conducting. In other words, there is no electrical connection between the source and drain. When N-type and P-type materials come in physical contact, a depletion region, shown in dark red in the diagram, forms at their junction. This is a region of substrate where the current-carrying electrical particles have migrated away from the junction. The depletion zone serves as an insulating layer between the substrate and source drain. The width of this insulating layer grows as the voltage of the source drain gets larger relative to the voltage of the substrate. And, as you can see in the diagram, that insulating layer fills the region of the substrate between the source and drain terminals, keeping them electrically isolated. Now, as VGS gets larger, positive charges accumulate on the gate conductor and generate an electrical field which attracts the electrons and the atoms in the substrate. For a while, that attractive force gets larger without much happening. But when it reaches the MOSFET's threshold voltage, the field is strong enough to pull the substrate electrons from the valence band into the conduction band, and the newly mobile electrons will move towards the gate conductor, collecting just under the thin oxide that serves as the gate capacitor's insulator. When enough electrons accumulate, the type of the semiconductor changes from P-type to N-type, and there's now a channel of N-type material forming a conducting path between the source and drain terminals. This layer of N-type material is called an inversion layer, since its type has been inverted from the original P-type material. The MOSFET switch is now closed or conducting. Current will flow from drain to source in proportional to VDS, the difference in voltage between the drain and source terminals. At this point, the conducting inversion layer is acting like a resistor governed by Ohm's law. So IDS is equal to VDS divided by R, where R is the effective resistance of the channel. This process is reversible. If VGS falls below the threshold voltage, the substrate electrons drop back into the valence band, the inversion layer disappears, and the switch no longer conducts. The story gets a bit more complicated when VDS is larger than VGS, as shown in the bottom figures. A large VDS changes the geometry of the electrical fields in the channel, and the inversion layer pinches off at the end of the channel near the drain. But with a large VDS, the electrons will tunnel across the pinch-off point to reach the conducting inversion layer still present next to the source terminal. How does pinch-off affect IDS, the current flowing from drain to source? To see, let's look at some plots of IDS on the next slide. Okay, this plot has a lot of information, so let's see what we can learn. Each curve is a plot of IDS as a function of VDS, for a particular value of VGS. First, notice that IDS is zero when VGS is less than or equal to the threshold voltage. The first six curves are all plotted on top of each other along the x-axis. Once VGS exceeds the threshold voltage, IDS becomes non-zero and increases as VGS increases. This makes sense. The larger VGS becomes, The more substrate electrons are attracted to the bottom plate of the gate capacitor, and the thicker the inversion layer becomes, allowing it to conduct more current. When VDS is smaller than VGS, we said the MOSFET behaves like a resistor obeying Ohm's law. This is shown in the linear portions of the IDS curves at the left side of the plots. The slope of the linear part of the curve is essentially inversely proportional to the resistance of the conducting MOSFET channel. As the channel gets thicker with increasing VGS, more current flows, and the slope of the line gets steeper, indicating a smaller channel resistance. But when VDS gets larger than VGS, the channel pinches off at the drain end, and as we see on the right side of the IDS plots, the current flow no longer increases with increasing VDS. Instead, IDS is approximately constant, and the curve becomes a horizontal line. We say that the MOSFET has reached saturation, where IDS has reached some maximum value. Notice that the saturated part of the IDS curve isn't quite flat, and IDS continues to increase slightly as VDS gets larger. This effect is called channel length modulation and reflects the fact that the increase in channel pinch-off isn't exactly matched by the increased current induced by the larger VDS. Whew! MOSFET operation is complicated. Fortunately, as designers, we'll be able to use the much simpler mental model of a switch if we obey some simple rules when designing our MOSFET circuits. Up to now, we've been talking about MOSFETs built as shown in the diagram on the left, with N-type source and drain diffusions in a P-type substrate. These are called N-channel MOSFETs, since the inversion layer, when formed, is an N-type semiconductor. The schematic symbol for an N-channel MOSFET is shown here, with the four terminals arranged as shown. In our MOSFET circuits, we'll connect the bulk terminal of the MOSFET to ground, which will ensure that the voltage of the P-type substrate is always less than or equal to the voltage of the source and drain diffusions. We can also build a MOSFET by flipping all the material types, creating P-type source drain diffusions in an N-type substrate. This is called a P-channel MOSFET, which also behaves as a voltage-controlled switch, except that all the voltage potentials are reversed. As we'll see, control voltages that cause an N-channel switch to be on will cause a P-channel switch to be off, and vice versa. Using both types of MOSFETs will give us switches that behave in a complementary fashion. Hence the name complementary MOS, CMOS for short, for circuits that use both types of MOSFETs. Now that we have our two types of voltage-controlled switches, our next task is to figure out how to use them to build circuits useful for manipulating information encoded as voltages.